Have any of you ever heard of the man Galileo? I'm sure most of you probably have. Galileo was an Italian astronomer, mathematician, brilliant man living in the latter part of the 16th century and into the middle of the 17th century. He is the father of a number of scientific inclusions that we now enjoy. He is the forefather of so many things that our science, our modern science, would say is in thanks to him. He was an Italian scientist from the city of Pisa, which I'm sure you might know and know well from the great tower, the Leaning Tower of Pisa. That's his home, Galileo. He even used that building to accomplish one of the things that we have learned from his brilliance, acceleration, as he dropped objects from high up on the tower to see what the result was as they fell to the earth. Much more prominent than that, any one particular scientific reality in that case, is his introduction of the scientific process that was before him unknown or unused in any way, and that is the idea of making a hypothesis only then to submit to the experiment that would either prove or disprove it. That's very normal in our world today, and we owe Galileo credit for that. The scientific process is his. But maybe the one that I want to refer to that Galileo contributed to our world today, hundreds of years after his life, throughout the last several hundred years as science has gone from him and beyond, is that the earth under Galileo was no longer the center of the universe. Prior to Galileo and all of his wisdom and knowledge and brilliance, prior to that, the earth was understood to be at the center of the universe. Made sense if you think about it. You look out in the night sky and we presumably are the hub of all things and everything circulates around us. Galileo learned differently. Taking a very crude, rudimentary telescope, he began to examine the night sky and he noticed some things. He noticed that the planet Jupiter had four moons that circulated it, beginning to deteriorate some of that idea that everything just kind of circulates around us here on this planet. Well, there are four moons that are finding their attachment to nothing other than Jupiter itself. He saw phases of planets and moons. Phases, what does that mean? The light as it moves around and took shape. It's interesting, almost humorous to realize that prior to Galileo, mankind thought that the moon was a flat circle in the sky. Makes sense, doesn't it? That's what it looks like. But thanks to Galileo, he realized that it was actually a sphere, the moon was, with craters and texture and phases, again, circulating. But ultimately, it led over time, all of these discoveries about astronomy, it led to the understanding that the earth was not at the center of the universe, and even in our own galaxy, the center of our galaxy was not the earth, but rather the sun. We take all this for granted today. We take all of it for granted that the sun is what the earth revolves around and other planets and the stars and far distant stars. All of those things seem very normal to us. But as you can imagine, 500 years ago, almost, Galileo was unleashing this now truth to us. You know what? Galileo was a believer. He loved God. And what motivated him in his scientific endeavors was God himself, the creator. But you know who hated what he was sharing? The Catholic Church despised what he was presenting, despised him for it, and held him as a heretic of these things. And for the latter portion of his life, he died. He left the remainder of his life and to death in prison, being silenced by the church. Why is that? Because Galileo was challenging the status quo. He was challenging the authority of, in this case, the church, to resist the idea that God has revealed himself openly and freely. And what was the concern of the church was that if you start to break free of what we think the Word of God teaches in the two-dimensional world, if you start to break that into the three-dimensional world, we will lose control. How is it that Joshua says the sun stopped in the sky, stopped rotating from east to west, if the earth is not the center of the universe? And how is it that that God's own Son, Jesus Christ, came if we are not more significant than a simple planetary body in the middle of a ever-increasing universe? For Galileo, that wasn't a problem. For the church at the time, it was. And he was considered a heretic. You see, when you challenge the status quo, you meet up against resistance, don't you? When you are bringing something that is new and not yet experienced to the fullest, and in fact, it creates a real fear and fright over those things on a much larger scale, even than Galileo and the Catholic Church of the early 17th century, is Paul describing to a group of believers growing in their understanding of who God is and how he has revealed himself. Paul is introducing something that is going to challenge the status quo of even more significance than Galileo. We've entitled this sermon series, The Incorruptible Gospel. Incorruptible Gospel. Outside of our first week, which was last Sunday, we looked at Matthew chapter 7. But from today onward, we are going to be in the book of Galatians to find out what Paul was going to say about this, in fact, incorruptible gospel and how important it was to the church, the earliest of the church. If you've got your copy of God's Word, I invite you to turn to Galatians chapter 1 in the New Testament, about midway through. Galatians chapter 1, in honor of the Word of God, I invite you to stand. I'll read it aloud from the New American Standard Bible, will be my version. The New American Standard Bible, beginning Galatians chapter 1, verse 1. I'll simply read the first 10 verses of the chapter. He says this, "Paul, an apostle, not sent from men, nor through the agency of man, but through Jesus Christ, the God and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren who are with me to the churches of Galatia, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins so that he might rescue us from this present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be the glory forevermore. Amen. I am amazed that you are so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel, which is really not another. Only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, he is to be accursed. As we have said before, so I say again, if any man is preaching to you a gospel contrary to what you have received, he is to be accursed. For am I now speaking the favor of men or of God? Or am I striving to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ." May God add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. You may be seated. The title of today's message, the series is Incorruptible Gospel. The message is the Apostleship of Paul. Galileo was just a normal mathematician, became a brilliant scientist, physicist, and astronomer. His reputation, the church did everything it could to squelch, to deem him a heretic so as to maintain the status quo. Paul knows in the book of Galatians, Paul knows that he is going to have to step into this issue that we will be talking about over the next several weeks, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's going to have to step into it with authority, that he is going to receive tremendous pushback on what he is going to tell us, what he is writing to the Galatians. He's going to experience tremendous opposition, already has, which is part of the reason why he is writing it. The churches of Galatia are the churches most likely that Paul himself helped to found only a few years prior, most likely, several years. If you remember in Acts chapter 13 and 14, if you've ever read, where Paul goes on his missionary journey, the first of his three missionary journeys, with his fellow brother in Christ, his friend Barnabas, the encourager. And they go and they build up these brand new outposts of the gospel of Jesus Christ, known as the church, in each of those areas. And he is now later writing back to them, years later, writing back to them, no doubt as a result of already opposition to him and to his message that he gave years before. Only a short time, it is beginning to crumble a little bit, certainly preserved by God himself. But the danger, and Paul recognizes it, this young church, or this collection of churches, this young movement is hanging in the balance. And it's hanging in the balance on one simple thing: the purity, the simplicity, and the reliability of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he is going to address that. The first point of today's message, the apostleship of Paul, kind of in a little clever way, is says who? Says who? We've heard the expression, right? When someone brings to us something, what is the question? Says who? We hear it among our children, don't we? Hey, you're not supposed to do that. Says who? Mom? Oh, okay. Dad? Says who? You see, when you're bringing something that is going to be in some way confrontational or really raise the bar, as we will find, raise the bar to immeasurable heights in truth, you're going to raise this bar, you're going to mess with the status quo, you better come strong. Says who? And that's what Paul does at the very beginning. It's not unlike most of his letters, for sure. Paul is always greeting his listeners, his readers. He's always greeting them. But Galatians certainly gives a picture of that greeting that it is a bit tenuous. It is a bit under strain. And he begins by saying this. Go back again to verse 1. Paul, an apostle. Very simply stated in those few words. We'll look at more in a moment. First thing I want you to recognize is that Paul, the word literally means little. Little. I don't know if you guys know your various name meanings of your name, right? The things that you can find, you can Google. What does Gordon mean? Quite frankly, I can't tell you. Paul, I can tell you. You know what it means? Little. Isn't that funny? He is going into battle. He is going into spiritual battle with the name Little One. Well, that's not going to work. That is not, you're going in with not a whole lot of ammunition. Little one, you could say, is Paul's opening statement. Little one, an apostle. Okay, well, what does that mean? Well, our formal understanding of apostle would be 13 men. We have in our minds, most likely if you're like me, the first time you hear the word apostle, you think of 13 men. Who are those 13 men? the 12 disciples who were with Jesus from his entire ministry, not Judas as one of the 12, but rather Matthias as one of the 12, but all the others that we know well, Peter, James, John, Simon, Thaddeus, Bartholomew, all of these individuals, these 12, including now Matthias, and then yet one late born, Paul, first known to us as Saul when he was a persecutor of the church, and now Paul, an evangelist and a missionary to the Gentile world. That's what we normally think of when we hear apostle. The word is not intrinsically about those 13 men. It doesn't mean that. It means messenger or sent one, one who is sent. And that could apply to any number of people. And so we haven't. So first, Paul calls himself little one by simply referring to his own name. Little one says, I'm an apostle. Okay, big deal. You still haven't hit anything big. How do I know, or what? Why would I say that? Well, there are other places where the term apostle is used. Notice one that is in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 23. As for Titus, he is my partner and fellow worker among you. As for our brethren, they are messengers of the churches, a glory to Christ. That's the same word, messengers, apostle. What is it saying? They are apostles. They are sent ones. The issue when you have a sent one is not the sent one, it's the sender. That's the issue. The sent one is relatively insignificant in the grand scheme of it all. It's why Paul can say in Galatians 1, little one, me, little one, an apostle. Well, he still hasn't necessarily hit it out of the park yet, because look here. Well, these are apostles of the churches. Hey, we want to keep in mind, these are valid brothers. This is not a diminishment. This is not a diminishing of their value. They are apostles of these particular churches. They have been sent by those churches. And there is validity in that. There is substance in that. But it is always about not the sent one, but the sender. And the authority in this example stops at the churches, if you will, right? That's the one who sent. That's who we are representing. Paul says, an apostle not sent by men or by the agency of man, but by whom? Through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. It's noted in the New International Greek Testament by F.F. Bruce, the commentary. They were, he's talking about that 2 Corinthians 8 example, they were apostles whose commission was entirely valid. That they were sent is not any small matter by those churches. They were valid, they were substantive apostles. But they took their character from those by whom they were commissioned. The authority was only as far as the one who was sending them. And so what is Paul saying is his authority? The person of Jesus himself. If he is going to come to the table strongly, if he is going to come and mess with the status quo, you'd better come with credential. And Paul is saying, I am an apostle. I'm a little one. Me, I'm little. But my sender is Jesus. He's my sender. It's interesting that he adds the phrase, raised from the dead. My sender is not in the grave, though some would like to believe. Saul, when he was the persecutor, Paul in his former known title, Saul, he was a persecutor of the church, and he was met on the road to Damascus by whom? The risen Jesus Christ. And he said to him, Paul, Saul, he said, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? The risen Christ visited with Saul that day on the road. And so when now Paul, known to us, when he says, I've been commissioned, he means, I stood before Jesus and he gave me this challenge. He comes with credentials. And he goes to great length. It's not long. It's only 5 verses that he introduces himself. But it is not to be seen as insignificant, but rather very meaningful. It's funny. Paul does this a lot. Whenever he greets someone in his letters, oftentimes the greeting is a window into something that he is going to say. Let me give you a different example. In the book of Philemon, Paul calls himself a slave. That's how he identifies himself. Well, that's interesting. Why would he do that? Because he is about to encourage Philemon, a believer but a slave owner, that a slave, Onesimus, receive him no longer as a slave but as a brother in Christ, because Onesimus had come to faith. And Paul led him to the Lord Jesus. And so what is Paul saying to Philemon? Philemon, we're all slaves. I am a slave. So as you welcome your former slave back into your company, don't welcome him as a slave. Welcome him as a brother. So even in an introduction, Paul has sort of an underlying message, doesn't he? And in this case, in Galatians, that is also true. Paul, an apostle of the risen Christ. He's going to go into battle over something that is more important than anything else he could battle over, and that's the purity of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And how can he do that? He himself is little. He says he is. Paul, little one. But I'm an apostle. I am a sent one of the risen Christ and of God the Father who raised him. He goes on to say that all the brethren who are with me to the churches in Galatia, I'm not alone in this. I have companions who stand with me in this message. He is further strengthening his credentials. And he says to them, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins that he might rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be the glory forevermore. Amen. As we continue to go through Galatians, all of those different words and phrases are going to be important. That Jesus is, as he describes him, Jesus is that he himself gave himself for our sins that he might rescue us from an evil present age, to the glory of God the Father forevermore. These are all going to be important as he can. It's like an outline, or it's like a window into the rest of the letter. And that is often the case with Paul's introductions. So as you think of, says who? Paul, an apostle of the risen Christ. Well, if says who is the first point, then say what? Say what? When you hear something strange, right? When you hear something out there and it doesn't mesh with what you understand, the natural response is, say what? And he tells us, I am amazed that you are so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel, which is really no other. Only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, he is to be accursed. As we have said before, so I say again now, if any man is preaching to you a gospel contrary to what you received, he is to be accursed. This is strong language. Look at some of the phrases that he brings into this and the offensiveness that this would likely be on would-be believers of this gospel, but are corrupting it. Look at some of the words. I'm amazed that you have so quickly deserted. Do you hear the power of that word? Desertion. Military soldiers are executed for desertion. Desertion is a powerful word. Imagine that a member of the church in Galatia, one of those churches that he is speaking to, Paul comes to them, remember, he's an apostle of the Lord Jesus. He's got his credentials, and he walks into the room, figuratively speaking, and he says, what are you doing deserting him who has called you? Deserting. They would have never imagined themselves deserting by simply adding a few extra rules to the gospel. That's not deserting. That's building our righteousness up. The gospel is the beginning, and then we add things to it to make our resume a little better. He calls it desertion. He says that by doing such things, by corrupting the gospel, you're deserting God. You are running from him in the complete opposite direction when they think all along they're running closer and closer to him. Paul says, you're deserting him. That's a powerful statement. What else does he say? We talked about it last week. He says, you're running from it you're deserting him for a different gospel, which is really no gospel. You don't even get to claim that you've got good news. You got bad news, folks. Then I'm astounded by the next one. He says, they are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we, or an angel from heaven, preaches a message contrary to the gospel, may he be accursed. An angel from heaven. There's two possibilities with this. Different people differ on what this is saying. Possibility number one, and they may both be true in one sense. It may be both and. One possibility, though, is that he is he is showing with great significance the gospel all the way to the point of where an angelic figure, the message is so critical that a celestial being who would deliver you some other message, may he be accursed. The messenger, angelic or otherwise, who would deliver to you a gospel different than the one I gave you from the beginning, don't listen to him. Really, an angel? I would think I'm supposed to listen to that. That's how critical the gospel is. If anyone, you could kind of say it's hyperbole, might be one interpretation. That all the way into the celestial heavens, if someone tries to deliver you a gospel that is different than the one I gave you from the beginning, may he be accursed. You know another possibility? That he has someone specifically in mind. Paul describes Satan as the angel of light, looking to deceive. And Satan is about whatever means necessary to undo what God is doing. Whatever means necessary. Let me take you back into a place that we know of as the wilderness with Jesus. Satan greets Jesus in the wilderness and he tempts him. He tempts him to do what? Satan is just 180 degrees opposed to the gospel, right? Satan doesn't want to get anywhere near the gospel, the true gospel message. No, Satan would love to get ever so close to the gospel, but twist it just enough that it is a lie. He doesn't go 180 degrees different. He goes just close enough that it deceives, but is still false. He's an angel of light. We'd know him if he just tried to flat out take us in a completely different direction. He hides himself in truth, in attempts at or partial truths to twist it and to make it lies. He did it to Jesus. Tried. He said, Jesus, you know, you're hungry. You can provide for yourself. Turn these stones into bread. Jesus said, Satan, you don't know. My Father and I have a plan. And you would seek to take us off of that. And it will not. But Jesus, it says in the Word, it says in Scripture that if you were to jump from the highest place from the temple, that your feet would not even strike the ground because he would send his angels and they would uphold you. Jesus knew what he was doing. Satan was looking to derail. That Jesus was going to do what? he was going to go to the cross, that it was going to involve suffering, that it was going to involve sacrifice, atonement for each and every one of us, and Satan wanted to just take him off course. When he says an angel from heaven that would teach you something contrary to this gospel, Satan could be the very one that Paul is thinking of in that moment. That's how important this message is, that he gets it right. And he calls it a contrary gospel. It's not just a little different. It is contrary. See, what they were dealing with, and we will learn this over the next several weeks, is that we have the Old Testament. We have all of these rules, these Jewish customs and practices and rules and laws. And so as you come into the New Testament and you see the person of Christ and you try and put him in as one of those things, you kind of just add him on, he's still, yes, he's the ultimate, but he's really just the next thing. We have to travel through all of those other laws and rules and customs in order to get to Jesus. He's just the next door that you walk through. My friends, Paul is saying he's a completely different door. He's a new and better way, Hebrews tells us, the book of Hebrews. He's a new and better way than anything that has come before. And when you try and add all of the previous things and just say, he's just one more thing, he's the next thing that you have to do, Paul is saying that is contrary. He is not just the next thing that you have to do. He is entirely unique. And by faith, you believe in what he has done for you and what he has accomplished. They thought it mattered that they would be circumcised or uncircumcised because it mattered before Jesus. It must matter now. And if you don't do that, you cannot really have access to Jesus. Or that you eat only with the right people. He's going to have to confront a good friend on that issue. We'll see in a few weeks. He is going to have to deal with the idea that does it matter how closely connected you are to Abraham? Well, I'm straight down the line. You can find Abraham all the way in my lineage. And these poor folks over here don't have access to Abraham, so therefore they don't have access to Christ. All of these things. And you would think that makes a guy or a gal more righteous, wouldn't you? And Paul says, this is damning to the gospel. It's very interesting that we all, when you mess with the status quo, it makes people very afraid. We probably should be a little sympathetic for that to them, right? That such a different message is being communicated that they can't help but keep running back to those old satisfying things. In 1989, I graduated from high school. In that summer between my graduation and my departure for my first year in college, those three or so months that I had a chance to do so, I worked. And my job, one of my more memorable jobs in my life as an 18-year-old kid, was to work on a horse farm that was just on the outskirts of my hometown. I lived in a city very similar to Hagerstown, about the same size, in a sense, with a lot of rural area around it. And there were a number of horse farms in the area that surrounded my hometown. I didn't know a lot about horses. I loved them, but I didn't know a lot about them. It was kind of cool to go to work every day and hang out. We actually had, it was a small-time horse farm. It wasn't big-time horse racing, but it was thoroughbreds. It was horse racing, just not of the Kentucky Derby kind. Or is it the Preakness? What's Maryland? Belmont. Preakness, thank you. But we would, small-time horse racing, we actually had an offspring of Secretariat, which was kind of cool. I got to work with an offspring of the legendary racehorse, Secretariat. But anyway, I would work during the summer in 1989, and that same summer, a neighboring farm, also a horse farm, had a big barn full of horses. The barn burned one night. I remember coming to work the next day and hearing about it. And that neighboring farm, the barn had burned and a number of their very valuable racehorses were consumed in the fire. You know what happened? It wasn't because the barn just simply burned down around them. They actually got to the barn in time to rescue most, if not all, of the horses. What they did is they went into the barn, they opened up all the stall, the doors of the stalls, and they began to shoo the horses out and kick them and get them to go. Just run, get away. They would send them out the long hallway of the barn and out into the open areas of the farm. What would they do? The horses were freaked, as you can imagine. They were completely undone, and what happened? They ran back in. That's what they knew in a moment of turmoil, in a moment of chaos. A horse was thinking, where am I safest? I'm in the barn. The barn was burning. In that situation, what they should have done was to wrap something around the eyes of the horse and send them out, because even in their blindness, they were safer than thinking that by seeing the barn and running back into it, they would be saved. And many of them perished in the fire as a result. This is something like that. You are running back towards a dead system. You're running back into a dead system. You are so afraid that if I don't circumcise, or if I don't, that I don't eat with the right people, or I'm not closely enough connected to Abraham, that I don't have access to Christ. And Paul is saying, Jesus is received by faith. You have nothing else that is going to achieve you his righteousness other than to receive him. Circumcision or not, eating with the right people or the wrong people, quote, or not being connected to Abraham closely enough, none of that has to do with this. Jesus saves all of you. He saves. It would be false for us to think that the Old Testament taught one thing and the New Testament taught something different. That is not, let me not allow you to think that that's what I'm saying. Paul himself said, this is the same thing, but we have gotten it wrong all along, which is why Jesus had to do what he did. In Romans chapter 9, verse 32, he says that the law should have been lived by faith. It should have always been lived by faith. Jesus is not new in the sense that, oh, wow, we used to keep the law and now we believe in Jesus by faith. The law was meant to be lived by faith. But because that failed, Jesus lived it. And in his life, I find mine. In his life, I am found. And because he lived it, I am freed, like those horses running out of the barn. You are free to live in liberty. You are free. Don't run back into the death of the rules that you cannot keep. Do not run back in. It is death for you. The last thing that we look at in verse 10, just say it. Just say it. In verse 10, he says, for am I now seeking the favor of men or of God? Or am I striving to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a bond servant of Christ. My friends, when it comes to the gospel, there are only two options. When it comes to the messenger that Paul was, he had only two options. You see, if he wanted to simply get along, go along to get along, if he just simply wanted to, you know, circumcision, you're right. I mean, yeah, that's probably a good idea to do it. If it's eating with the right or the wrong people, I get it. I know why you're bothered by that. I know why these rules you feel like you need to keep. And you know what? So I don't want to rock the boat. So go ahead, do it. He said, if I'm trying to please men, then I'm not going to please God. If I'm trying to please God, then I'm a slave, a bondservant of God. And I cannot worry about what men would say. I can't. It would be interesting if I were to get up here and try and teach you something that is terribly, it feels very uneasy. And I don't know, maybe this is it. I don't know. It feels very uneasy. And you go, Gord, man, that we don't buy that. You know what? I would want you to test the scriptures. I want anything that I say, I would never want you to take my word for it alone. You hear it, go back and seek it for yourself. I am a believer in that practice. Go and seek it for yourself. But I also want you to know this. I am accountable to him, not you. You are accountable to you, not me, in that sense. In that way, we're all accountable to each other. But what Paul is saying here is that as a bondservant of God, I am accountable to him. And if I'm accountable to him, I'm not accountable to you, and vice versa. If I'm accountable to you, I have no longer set myself accountable to him. I can't have it both ways. And the gospel of Jesus Christ is so critical to the trajectory of the church, where the church is going to go. We have not, 2,000 years later, moved into finer things than the gospel. We have not moved into greater and grander things. You know, the gospel was good for those first few hundred years. We're kind of on to something new. The gospel is the message. It will be today, tomorrow. If you're a believer, it is your message. If you're an unbeliever and you never heard it before, let me tell you, Jesus saves. He has rescued you. He has said, you can't achieve righteousness on your own. I have done it for you. If you would receive this gift by faith, it is yours, and you can live in liberty. If you're an unbeliever, the gospel is for you today. If you are a believer, please never get the idea that the gospel is something in your past. It tells us every morning that we wake up, Gordon, you can't do this. You will never be able to do it. The obedience that you live through me. Do I want you to live good works? We've talked about it endlessly for the past couple of months. Do I want you to achieve great works and bear much fruit? Yes. And that happens on one simple, the basis of one thing, that you are united with Christ. And his works will be your works. Of course, exhibit good works. Of course. But it is Christ who lives in me. We'll see that in a few weeks. Christ who lives in me, manifesting his works. And if we ever try and attach, like barnacles on a ship, something that is more than that gospel, that simple, pure message, then we are deserting him who has called us by the grace of Christ. We don't want to desert. We don't want to desert him. We want to be with him. I close with this. The authority that Paul had to come to this was so very important. If any of us were to receive, and some of you have, received the news of some ailment that is beyond any of us, or a loved one. If anyone has ever been diagnosed with cancer, there's a handful of places they want to go. I want to hear what MD Anderson in Houston has to say about my cancer. Or Sloan Kettering, is that right, in New York? Or maybe the Mayo Clinic up in Minnesota. Someone gets a cancer diagnosis, and it really is helpful to think, what are the experts? What is the authoritative voice on this issue? If you've got cardiac issues, it might be the Cleveland Clinic. And really, one of the finest hospitals in the entire world is merely an hour plus away from here, Johns Hopkins. And when you think about the brilliance and the experts, you want to know what, there are wonderful doctors and nurses and caregivers all over the country and all over the world that are not directly linked. But you know who oftentimes those doctors and nurses and caregivers look to? What are they saying at MD Anderson? What are they saying at the Mayo Clinic on cancer research? What are they saying at Johns Hopkins? Because there's an authority there. And Paul begins this whole process by saying, the authority, not me, the authority is Jesus himself. and he is the one delivering this message through me. He is going to get into some serious battles. When you have cancer, you want an answer. When you've got a problem, when you've got a corrupt gospel, you need Jesus to sweep in and clarify what has been corrupted. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Let's not complicate it. Let's simplify it. Okay? Let's pray. Dear Lord, bless this hour we have spent. Lord, may your Holy Spirit take the words, your word, dig a little hole in the dirt of our heart, plant it, water it, feed it, and allow it to grow. Let the gospel, Lord, we pray that the gospel would be a plant that is so very small and pure and simple, but that gives life to our entire souls. Lord, the gospel is all that we can lean into, and we don't want to corrupt it. We don't want to add, take away. We don't want to make something that it isn't. Lord, we want the gospel to give life as you have intended it. Thank you for it. Thank you for the good news that Jesus saves, that he came, that he lived the perfect life, that he satisfied all of your demands that we could not. And in satisfying them, he took with him to the cross every sin that any of us have, are, or will ever commit. Nailed it to the cross and said, now, through the resurrection which you brought him back 3 days later, now I give new life. Live it. That's the gospel, Lord, and that's all we can depend on. We love you and we pray this in the name of Jesus, who loved us and gave himself up for us. Amen.